Good morning, everyone. It is 10 o'clock a.m., so it's probably a good time to start. Hello, and welcome to CyberSafe in the Gigabit City version 3.0. My name is Wes Hill. I'm the Dean of Business and Applied Technologies here at Wilson Community College. We thank you for taking time to join us today. We also welcome you to October, and for our purposes, Cybersecurity Awareness Month. We hope you come away with this with a much better knowledge of how to keep yourself cyber safe during the pandemic. I'd like to welcome Mr. Rob Holston, our Vice President for Academic Affairs, to give us a few words from the college.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome. As Mr. Hill said, my name is Rob Holston. I'm the Vice President for Academic Affairs here at the college, and we welcome you to Wilson Community College, albeit virtually today, and CyberSafe in the Gigabit City version 3.0. And for those of you who are not mathematically inclined, that is our third CyberSafe event, which would indicate that there's still an ongoing need for us to learn about and be safe in a digital cyber world. Unfortunately, that's still where we are. Today, you're going to hear from a really distinguished speaker, Dr. Mark Ciampa, who has a wealth of experience and knowledge in the area of IT and cybersecurity. We really look forward to hearing his remarks and his words of wisdom. And we'll also hear from panelists who will talk about their ideas and their experiences with dealing and protecting ourselves in a cyber world. So we do welcome you to the college, and anything that we can do while you're attending the webinar, just let us know, put something in the chat. But I look forward to hearing everybody's words and remarks, and everybody please stay safe while you're in a digital world.
Thank you, Mr. Holston, for those words. We appreciate it. So in a normal year, we'd all be sitting in the Eagle Center or Del Mastro on our beautiful campus to listen to this program. But as obviously as safety prevails, we're doing this virtually. And I'm pretty sure I said this last year. We hope that version 4.0 will be in person and back on campus next October. All right, so we've had this long-standing relationship with the City of Wilson, Greenlight and Gig East Exchange, Wilson Community College has. And this extends to our Information Technology Certificate and Degree programs, where members of their staff serve on our IT Advisory Board. They assist with credit and non-credit programs and assist with internships and job opportunities for students. So we are very especially grateful to Gene Scott, Will Acock, Brittany Smith, and their teams for their continued support and for being a co-sponsor of this program. And I personally would like to extend my thanks to Ms. Kendra Faulkner, who is the brainchild and one of the organizers of this event, and to Susan Weekly and her staff for making sure all the technical side is in working order. Did you know that according to a report from Malwarebytes, one out of every five businesses in the United States had a cyber attack due to the negligence of an employee working from home? Did you also know that there has been a 400% increase of cyber attack complaints to the FBI since the beginning of the pandemic? And did you know that over 500,000 Zoom accounts have been made available in public to the dark webs due to data breaches during the pandemic? This is an example of why this program provides such an important discussion. We hope that this gives you an opportunity to learn how to protect yourself from a cyber attack, especially as cyber criminals use the pandemic as an opportunity to prey on businesses and individuals. This year's speaker is Dr. Mark Ciampa. He is an information systems professor at Western Kentucky University. Dr. Ciampa has authored over 25 technology textbooks covering areas such as computer security, computer networking, wireless data technologies, and health information technology. His recent book, Security Plus Guide to Network and Security Fundamentals, 7th edition, is the number one bestseller in the computer network security field worldwide. And it's also one of our books too at the college. He has published over 20 articles in the peer-reviewed journals. He is a frequent speaker at regional and national publisher events and recently conducted workshops for the National Security Agency, National Centers of Academic Excellence in Cyber Defense. He writes a weekly blog on security that currently has a readership of more than 10,000 followers. Dr. Ciampa, welcome to Wilson Community College, and thank you for providing our keynote address for today's event. The floor is all yours.
Great, thank you very much, Wes. Let me get my screen sharing here. Yeah, there we go, good. I want to thank Wilson for the invitation to participate in your CyberSafe in the Gigabit City 3.0. And I want to thank you for attending this. I know that everyone has very busy lives, particularly this time of year. So thank you for taking your time to be part of this CyberSafe in the Gigabit City. Oh, there we go. COVID-19. I am so tired of even thinking about COVID-19. How COVID-19 has just upended our world is beyond description. But as Wes has already said, COVID-19 likewise has upended the world of cybersecurity. We're seeing more and different types of attacks today since the start of COVID-19 about a year and a half ago than we saw prior to that time. So I thought it might be interesting for us to kind of look at cybersecurity through the lens of COVID-19. Again, as if worrying about COVID-19 by itself was bad enough, this virus has unleashed a new wave of cybersecurity attacks. Now, some of these attacks are a continuation of what was going on prior to the pandemic, but many of them are new and they're more focused than they used to be. And as Wes has already told us, users are the prime target of attackers. So what we'll look at in the next 30 minutes or so in this presentation is we'll look at some of the biggest COVID-19 era attacks. We'll see how and why they occurred. But most importantly of all, we're going to look at defenses that we as users can take in order to protect ourselves from these cyber attacks in our COVID-19 world. So this is going to be basically our outline. We'll look at some COVID-19 cybersecurity events, and then we'll look at some self-vaccinations that we can do to protect ourselves against these attacks. And occasionally throughout this presentation, you're going to see a slide that looks like this. When you see this slide, it means the following slide has a question for you. Now, we're not going to do a Zoom poll through these questions, but I do have a question that I'd like for you to consider. So when you see this slide, I like to tell my students, this is a wake-up slide because the next one will have the question on it. So let's start talking about COVID-19 cybersecurity events. What's been going on in the cybersecurity world since COVID-19 broke out back in March of 2020? Looks like a nice retired couple, doesn't it? Oh, looks like you've got a question. Let's see what it is. Credit card abuse. What is your legal maximum liability if your credit card number is stolen and used? Are you liable for nothing, $50, $500, or is there no limit to your liability? Well, the answer is $50. If your credit card is stolen and someone takes it and they charges a whole bunch of stuff against it, then by law, you are only liable for $50. Oh, looks like we've got another question here. What is your legal maximum liability if your debit or ATM card is stolen and used? Again, zero, 50, 500, or no liability? Well, the answer here is a little bit different. It depends when you report the card was stolen. If you report a stolen ATM debit card within 2 days, you're only liable for $50. But if it takes you up to 60 days to report a stolen card, then you're liable for $500. And if you don't report the card after 60 days, then you could be liable for the entire amount that someone uses your card for. Let's talk about your retirement account now. What is your legal maximum liability if funds in your retirement account are stolen through a cyber-related attack? Now, for old people like me who are getting close to retirement, that's really something that's important because, yeah, there's money in retirement that has been accumulated through a lot of years, and I've got to depend on that money to get me through after I leave teaching. So, what is the maximum liability that you would face if funds were stolen out of your retirement account based on a cyber-related attack? Would you be liable for zero, 50, 500, no liability? The answer may surprise you. There's no limit to your liability, meaning if all of the money was taken, there is no obligation for that money to be put back into your account by the organization that is managing your retirement. Wow. Now, this is a really busy screen with a lot of stuff on it. We're not going to read through all this sort of stuff. But basically what it says is, that last bullet point, we don't have federal regulations right now. And there have not been court decisions established as to who is responsible. So right now, if something happens to your retirement account, because it is the victim, you are the victim of a cyber attack, your entire retirement account is vulnerable. Since COVID-19, we have seen attackers focus their attention on individuals' retirement accounts. Give you two examples of two victims and two subsequent lawsuits. In April of 2020, Heidi claimed that her former employer and her 401k plan record keeper violated some federal regulations because they didn't protect the money that was in her account. And back in 2019, Heidi received a written letter from her former employer, Abbott, that per her request, $245,000 was taken out of her retirement account and transferred into a bank account. And Heidi said, wait a minute, I didn't ask for any sort of money to be transferred at all. And of course, the money had long been sucked out of that bank account to which it was transferred. So Heidi had $245,000 of her retirement account disappear like that. Now, she sued, and the court ruled that her former employer, Abbott, had not committed a breach of duty, and the claims were dismissed. Now, some of the claims against the 401k plan keeper were dismissed, but one of them actually was not. So it's continuing its way through court. And then last year, another individual suffered the theft of $124,000 out of his 401k account. And these are just two of the high profile accounts we know, because these individuals turned around and filed suit. So we're seeing more and more attackers focusing on individual retirement accounts and siphoning off those precious dollars. How is this happening? Well, let's take a look at how Heidi's account was compromised. It all started with the attacker getting into Heidi's personal email account. Heidi perhaps had repeated that password on her email account on multiple accounts, or maybe used a really weak password. Anyway, the attacker was able to get into Heidi's personal email account. And then the attacker went to the 401k account manager site and clicked forgot password. Well, what happened then? Well, the password reset was sent to Heidi's personal email account that the attacker had already gotten into. So the attacker then used that link to change the password on the 401k account, and then of course deleted the email that came in. Next, the attacker logged into the 401k account because he had just changed the password to something he knew. And he changed the user preferences, you know, the contact phone number, the preferred contact method, that sort of thing. And then the attacker submitted a request to have the funds moved to this other bank account. And guess what? When the account manager got in touch with who they thought was Heidi, asking for approval, because the attacker had changed Heidi's contact information, they actually were calling the attacker for over-the-phone approval to move the fund. And of course, the attacker said yes. Wow. Now, what we're seeing is, through COVID-19, financial institutions are no longer just routinely storing stolen money from an account. Instead, the financial institutions are actually inquiring, what type of security the victim had in protecting their account. You know, if the victim had a weak password or a password that was repeated on multiple accounts, that says that perhaps the victim is not really concerned about securing the money in the account. And thus the victim should share in some sort of liability. And the institutions may only return a portion of the stolen funds. And you can see here that Heidi only got back a little over $100,000 of her stolen money. So we're starting to see pushback more and more from those organizations that have money stolen because an individual had weak security. Now, the Government Accountability Office was actually asked by Congress to look into this situation. And here's part of what they said, and it's kind of long and drawn out, but you notice the very last sentence of this quote. Until the Department of Labor, DOL, clarifies responsibilities for the fiduciaries and provides minimum cybersecurity expectations, participants, that is us, data and assets, that is our money, will remain at risk. So the Government Accountability Office says we've got a bad situation here. If funds are stolen out of your retirement account, there's no federal regulation that requires them to be put back. Wow. How can we self-inoculate? How can we come up with a vaccine to prevent this from happening against us? Well, we'll talk about that in just a few moments. Let's talk about next something called ransomware. I hope you've never ever seen this on your computer, that it says that all of your files are encrypted. We actually have gone through different phases of ransomware. It's kind of interesting to go back and look to see how we have landed in today's world of ransomware. Ransomware first started appearing about the year 2010. And the earliest ransomware would display a screen that prevented the user from getting into their computer and actually doing anything. This is called blocker ransomware. And the instructions, that were displayed on the screen to the victim pretended to be from a reputable third party that had a valid reason for blocking access to your computer. Sometimes these messages pretended to come from law enforcement. You know, you've accessed a prohibited site and you have to pay some sort of fine before you can continue to do something with your computer. And sometimes the message pretended to come from a software vendor. You know, your software license has expired, or maybe there's a hardware problem, or kind of an irony here, maybe there's a malware infection. And so everything is closed down until you pay the fee for this new software to unlock everything. Yeah, it might look something like this. These were kind of typical. Looks like it might come from the FBI. You've been doing the wrong thing, it said. Your computer is locked up until you pay this fine. Here's another one similar to that. What I like about this one particularly is that I really like this nice three-step process an individual has shown on the right side of the screen there for paying. I like it when attackers are customer focused, don't you? And yet here's another one as well. It said your computer is infected, it's locked up. Pay this money for this new software to protect your computer. That was ransomware version one. Ransomware version two, however, is much more malicious. Instead of blocking access to our computer, now they started encrypting everything so no files could be opened. We call that crypto malware. And they would tell the victim, you have to pay a fee in order to get the key to unlock your files. And they also added an urgency. You know, the cost for unlocking the files is $500 if you pay today. But if you wait till tomorrow, the cost for unlocking is $600. 24 hours after that, the cost is $700. And guess what? If you wait more than 4 days, you'll never get the key to unlock your files. Well, this created a sense of urgency and caused individuals to say, oh, I need to pay very quickly. And they did. Yeah, individuals who would have crypto malware, this ransomware version 2.0, might see something like this. And sometimes they even contain one of these countdown counters that said you've got X number of hours left in order to pay or else you'll never get the key to unlock your file. And in ransomware version 3, we started seeing a narrowing of the victim and stealing data. You know, ransomware has turned into what's called a crime of opportunity. No longer do attackers just cast a wide net because they might snare people who can't afford to pay the ransom. So attackers today are narrowly focused on who the victims are. And you can see here that they seek out those victims that they know cannot afford to be down for any length of period of time, and thus they're inclined to pay much more rapidly. First on the list, manufacturing companies. Second, professional services. And look, schools and colleges are the third most popular victim of ransomware attacks today. And ransomware attackers are using what's called blended attacks to put more pressure on the victims to pay. First, they'll steal the data before they lock it up. And if the victim refuses to pay the ransom, the attackers will threaten to release the stolen data. So it kind of puts the victims in a bind. You know, I might be able to restore from a backup so that the ransomware attack is negated, but I might then face a penalty if the attackers send this data out, make it public. That leads us to ransomware version 4, extortion. In April this year, Apple was set to announce several new products at its spring-loaded event. But at the same time, a ransomware gang said they had stolen the data and the schematics from Apple's hardware supplier. And this ransomware gang said they're going to sell the data to the highest bidder unless Apple pays a ransom of $50 million. So they're holding hostage the data that they stole. And this also occurred to the Acer computer company as well. But now we're into ransomware version 5, if you would. What attackers are doing today is they're doing double encryption. They'll encrypt the data with one type of ransomware, but they'll re-encrypt it with another type of ransomware. So that if the victim were to get the key for unlocking the first type, they probably wouldn't have the key for unlocking the second type. And also this version 5, attackers are encrypting some of the organization's data with ransomware A, but another type of ransomware is used to encrypt other types of data. So again, the victims have to buy two decryption keys instead of just normally one. And ransomware doesn't just affect our local computer. Ransomware can affect anything that is connected to our computer through, let's say, our wireless router. Ransomware could affect our smartphone, in fact. And it can even affect things like Dropbox. If I use Dropbox and ransomware infects my computer, it will not only lock up the files on my computer, but will also lock up the files that I have stored out there on Dropbox. And maybe I put files out there on Dropbox as a backup to protect myself from ransomware. So whatever is connected to my computer potentially can be locked up. This is a news article that came out on Tuesday of this week that really caught my attention. This gentleman is the director of the National Security Agency, NSA, very high profile government agency. Notice that he says that ransomware is a national security issue. Wow. Ransomware has elevated to the point that it's a national security issue. He also points out there's been an increase of about 300% or so of ransomware attacks over the last year. But here's an interesting twist. Ransomware, paying it, could be a tax advantage. You know, when you pay your income tax, there are deductions that you can take to lower what the amount is that your tax is based on. You know, if I have, let's say, charitable contributions to a church or an organization, I can deduct those to lower the amount of tax I have to pay. And businesses likewise can do the same thing if these expenses are what are called, quote, ordinary and necessary. And so many tax experts are saying now that if a business has to pay a ransomware payment, then they should be able to deduct that on their taxes because those payments are ordinary and necessary. They're necessary in order for the business to get back in its feet quickly. But with the huge increase in the number of ransomware attacks, these now are ordinary. And what's fascinating is the Internal Revenue Service says, yeah, we're aware of this and we're looking at it. So it kind of tells us how broad spread ransomware attacks have become for them to be deemed now just ordinary. What can I do to protect myself against ransomware attacks? We'll talk about that in a moment. Oh, let's talk about routers. Yeah. More individuals were working at home during COVID-19, and many still are. So attackers started to focus their attention on wireless routers. These are the things, of course, that connect our computer to the internet and through which our data flows. Consumer wireless routers are generally sold as just maintenance-free products you set up and forget. You know, you just plug them in and off you go. If you've ever had a problem with a wireless router and you've had to call tech support, their answer is pretty much the same. You know, just turn the router off and then turn it back on. Well, wireless routers are not just a basic appliance, but they're really sophisticated servers, usually running the Linux operating system. And they have software that does network management and firewall and routing. And servers are complicated devices. And those who are taking information technology classes know that servers require ongoing maintenance and even security patching. Yet how many consumers know how to patch and maintain their wireless router? We simply assume that the manufacturer is going to take care of all of that. Well, some bad news. There's a study done recently of 127 brand new out-of-the-box routers. None of these routers was secure. In fact, one out of three used a version of Linux, the operating system, that was released, that's right, in October 2010 and has 233 known vulnerabilities. And as someone who did this study said, you can walk in a store today and buy a brand new router powered by software that's 10 years old. But what about updates? Well, they also looked at how many updates had been sent out to these wireless routers. And the average number of days since the last update in these wireless routers, you can see, was over a year. And one of the devices had not been updated in 5 years. Now, this prompted someone else to do a study where they looked at 14 wireless routers that were for sale right now in a store. Go down to Best Buy, see 14 routers sitting there. None of these routers had been updated in the last 14 months. Wow. How can we protect ourselves when our wireless routers are suspect? We'll talk about that. Oh, one more. Multi-factor authentication, MFA. You know, when I log in using a password, with MFA, I'll also get a message on my smartphone that says, hey, enter this code as well in order to get in. And that is widely advertised as being super secure by entering a password and also using this multi-factor authentication. But is it that secure? There was an interesting article that an individual said, a hacker got all my texts for $16. That's right. For $16, a hacker could take over your text messages, that is, the things that are sent to you, this MFA, and reroute it to their own phone. Wow. And also, a lot of times we use public Wi-Fi. Well, if I'm using public Wi-Fi for my phone and that code comes into my phone that says, enter this in addition to your password, guess what? An attacker could grab that out of the air. There are also things called a port out attack. This is when an attacker contacts your wireless, another wireless carrier, not yours, but another wireless carrier, and pretends like you want to switch over to them. So the attacker then says, I want you to change to this new phone number. Well, what happens, of course, is that new phone number is the attacker's phone number. So everything that was going to your smartphone is now going to the attacker's smartphone. And there's something also called a SIM swap as well. And we'll talk more about that in just a few minutes. But how can we protect ourselves if multi-factor authentication doesn't work? Well, let's look at how we can protect ourselves from these various types of attacks. Let's begin by talking about, remember, the retirement account attacks. You remember that the attacker got into Heidi's personal email account and reset everything? So let's talk about protecting our email accounts. Here's a question for you. Which of these passwords is the strongest? Is it A? Is it B, C, or they're all equally strong? Most individuals would be surprised to learn that this is the strongest password of the bunch. That's right, not the complex one, but the long one. A colleague and I at school recently did a poll of over 520 salaried management professionals, and we asked them some questions about their passwords. We asked them which of these two passwords is most secure, and we asked them, what's the average length of your password? We were very surprised that only 7% of these individuals knew that the long password was the strongest password. And the average length of their passwords was a measly 9.7 characters. That's nothing. An attacker can easily break that in almost no time. How? It all relates to Rubik's cubes, if you're wondering. You know, I've got a 2x2 Rubik's Cube sitting here on my desk. By the way, it's advertised for individuals who are ages 8 and up. And a 2x2 Rubik's Cube could be solved in as few as 14 steps, okay? But I've also got a 3x3 Rubik's Cube. I've added another row here. Well, which is going to take longer for me to solve, the 2x2 or the 3x3? Well, everybody would say, well, it's going to take longer to solve the 3x3 than it's going to take for the 2x2. That's right. What about a 4x4? When you compare a 4x4 against a 2x2, which one is quicker? Well, it's going to be the 2x2. What if I take a 5x5 and compare it to a 2x2? Which one can be solved most quickly? Everyone would say it's going to be the 2x2. Well, keep that in mind when you think about your passwords. Yeah, here are all the various combinations. As we add just one more row to our Rubik's Cube, you can see that we're adding a tremendous number of possible combinations. And that's the idea behind passwords. Short passwords like a 2x2 Rubik's Cube can be quickly broken by attackers. Long passwords like a 5x5 Rubik's Cube take much longer. If you want to make your passwords strong, make them long. You may not remember much of what we talked about today, but there's one thing I'd like for you to walk away with. Long is strong in terms of passwords. Yeah, you can see here that if I have a password of just 2 characters in length, wow. That only gives 10,000 possible passwords for an attacker to go through until they find my password. But if my password is 3 characters in length, the number of possible passwords is 1.1 million. 4 characters in length, 116 million, and on and on. Want to make your passwords strong? Make them long. But someone will say, I can't remember long passwords. And that's absolutely true. Don't use your brain for remembering passwords, but use technology instead. Use a password manager. Now, a password manager is like a secure vault in which all of our passwords are stored. So I don't need to remember the passwords in my vault. All I need to remember is the one strong password to get into my vault. And password managers have features like they will allow you to create random passwords. every security professional I know recommends you must use a password manager to store your password. Now, I'm going to share with you something that I probably should not do, but I trust all of you, right? I'm going to show you one of my passwords that connected to a financial entity. Here it is. Oh, wow. Do I know what this password is? No. Do I care what this password is? No. All I care about is knowing the password that gets me into my password manager vault. And my passwords are of this length and complexity, but I don't even have to try to remember them. When you use a password manager, I'd recommend not using the storage feature in a web browser. There generally are two levels of password managers, one for just average users and one for kind of IT professionals. If you're the IT professional, there's something called KeePass, which I would recommend. If you don't consider yourself an IT professional, there's something called Bitwarden that I would seriously recommend. Both of these are free, open source, and they're very secure. But if you use a password manager, don't do this. Don't try to create a password that's easy to memorize and then stick it in your password manager. No. Use the password manager's random feature to create a random long password and then just store it in your password manager. And make your passwords long, because long is strong. Now, we started this conversation by talking about how to protect our retirement accounts. Something else that's really good to do is contact your plan administrator and tell that person that, hey, don't take any sort of request for transfer unless we have that conversation face to face, or at least over the phone where you recognize my voice. That's exactly what I did with my plan administrator for my retirement account. I told him, don't make any changes on my plan unless we meet face to face about it. Even if you get a request from someone that looks like it's me, don't honor it. So that's one good thing to do to protect your retirement account. Let's talk about ransomware quickly. You want to protect anything that's connected to your computer. If you have an external storage device, unplug it if you're not using it. Because if your computer gets infected, the files on your storage device could get infected. And if you use cloud repositories like Dropbox, turn them on to upload things there and then turn it off so that if your computer gets infected, your cloud repository will not get infected. Now, interestingly, if you use Microsoft Windows, Microsoft has a very good ransomware protection built right into it. This is called control folder access, and it doesn't allow other apps like ransomware to get to your data files. We're not going to go through it. I'm just going to say that the control folder access ransomware protection in Microsoft Windows is really good, and I'd encourage you to take a look at it. Let's talk about your routers. Don't rush out and buy a new router, because you could purchase one that's 10 years old. You really don't have a lot of options here. You could set up an old computer as a router, but that's pretty complicated. You could go from a consumer router to an enterprise level router. That's more expensive. You might consider these brands that are listed here. They seem to do a better job of keeping routers updated. What about multi-factor authentication? You can set something called a SIM PIN on your phone that will not allow attackers in to try to transfer your phone number to their phone. There's also something called a SIM lock PIN that does essentially the same thing. So you can investigate these a little bit so an attacker can't have your text messages sent to their phone and negate multi-factor authentication. Wow. We've in this COVID-19 world, things have changed and attacks have changed as well. We've talked about some ways to inoculate yourself, to keep yourself protected. and cyber safe in the gigabit city. So thanks very much. I'll stop sharing my screen here and I'll turn it back over to Kendra.
Good morning. Can everyone hear me? My name is Kendra Faulkner and I'm an information technology instructor here at Wilson Community College. Thank you, Dr. Ciampa, for that enlightening and increasingly relevant keynote message. Lots of great information there that really makes us think. The shocking information about our bank accounts and retirement accounts, and the bit about consumer router security and multi-factor authentication, lots of great information. I will now introduce our wonderful panelists. Our first panelist is Michael Bowden. Michael is from Mount Gilead, North Carolina, and he currently works at Stanley Community College as an Academy Support Specialist and a Cisco Networking Academy instructor. He is a former student of Stanley Community College and holds an Associate in Applied Science in Information Technology, Networking, and Security. Michael also holds a Cisco Certified Network Associate certification in Routing and Switching and has 10 years of IT experience in the healthcare field. Josh Edwards is our second panelist. Josh is a Wilson native. He has been an IT professional since 2011 with roughly 10 years of healthcare IT experience at Wilson Medical Center. Josh has served in many roles ranging from support center associate to server analyst. He is a Wilson Community College graduate and also recently graduated from East Carolina University, where he majored in industrial technology with a concentration in information and computer technology and a minor in industrial technology management. He also serves as a member of the Wilson Community College Advisory Committee for IT. And when Josh is not working with all things technology, he enjoys kayaking, wood turning, playing guitar, and spending time with friends and family. Our third panelist is Flavio Guzman. Flavio is a current student in the Wilson Academy of Applied Technology, majoring in information technology, networking, and cybersecurity. His favorite courses are security administration and Windows Server administration, and he specifically enjoys learning about identifying normal network traffic using network analysis tools. When not in class, Flavio enjoys reading the latest news on cybersecurity, and he hopes to one day work at Greenlight or a similar organization. Our fourth panelist today is Ashley Harris. Ashley is the Community Exchange Coordinator for the City of Wilson. As the coordinator at the Gig East Exchange for the city, her focus is creating a cohesive ecosystem that fosters growth and sustainability. Relative to her career in local government, Ashley enjoys working with the youth and giving back to the community. Chris Talbot is our fifth panelist. Chris is a current information technology, networking, and cybersecurity student at Wilson Community College. He has 10 years of operations management experience in the recycling industry. He enjoys learning all the intricate details of how networking allows us to communicate so quickly with people all over the world. Chris is enthusiastic about cybersecurity and is eager to learn more about ethical hacking and techniques that are used by malicious hackers. Chris is a stay-at-home father and a proud parent of one son, Christopher Jr. We will now hear from these panelists about how to be cyber safe in a pandemic. So for financial assets that were mentioned earlier in the keynote, we'll start with Michael. No doubt there has been an increase in cybersecurity attacks, especially ones on financial assets. Password managers have been recommended as one of the best ways to protect our accounts. So what are your thoughts on password managers? Do you use one? Is there one that you recommend or that is recommended by your organization? And what might be some things to be aware of when using a password manager? So Michael, we'll start with you.
Yes, for me, password managers, I like them. my first introduction was KeePass years ago when I first started at the healthcare facility. And it was real valuable because coming in at a help desk role where you had plenty of applications that all the help desk folks would log into as an admin, instead of having to remember all those passwords, I thought it was really neat that I could go in, remember that one main password and go into KeePass and get the admin password for whatever systems I needed to log in. So with that being said, after that, we stuck with it at the facility I was at. And then upon changing jobs, I got introduced to LastPass, which I've switched to that and I've been using it. One thing to watch out for is the password managers that save to the cloud opposed to that the ones that actually save locally on a database. You know, the ones that save to the cloud, pretty much if you ain't got no internet connection, then you're pretty much stuck in the water. So I lean towards KeePass, but for someone who's not into IT or ease of use, I would say LastPass also.
Josh, how about you?
Sure. So my experience with the password management has been fairly good. I have used a few different tools and I see that they have some benefits in many circumstances, and in some circumstances they can be a little more of a hindrance. Building on Michael's experience there with being able to share passwords with coworkers and colleagues, a password manager is a really good tool for using to do that task. For personal passwords, when you don't need to share your passwords, keeping something that you can manage is definitely important. I don't particularly care for a password manager. I prefer to come up with a complex password on my own that I can relate to and kind of commit to memory. But there are some times where a password manager is appropriate to use.
Thank you. Flavio?
I personally would recommend password managers. For me personally, between school and personal accounts that I use in the internet, it's really good to not be able to not have to memorize everything. And the one that I personally use is the one that my phone provides for me, Samsung Pass, which is really neat because I don't need to memorize even the admin password for that. It's locked by biometrics. So I just put my fingerprint on my phone and I have all the passwords that I need there.
Thank you. Ashley?
So I do use them in personal use. However, I don't use password managers for any sites that may have credit card information saved on them for payments. I also like to use password managers that do use biometrics for you to enter them or either written or scanned. So I don't use them for work-related things, but I do use them for a few personal accounts.
Thank you. Chris?
Hey, so I use the Apple software password manager that's built in. I'm a big Apple fan. Most of my devices are Apple. And just recently, they have allowed the transfer from the Apple compatibility password manager onto a Windows computer through either Chrome or Microsoft Edge. So you can actually use the password manager from Apple outside of an Apple product, which has been really helpful for me.
The second question, often related to financial information, most of us receive several calls every week that are simply imposter scams, robocalls, the result of scammers preying on common fears about the coronavirus. So what are some tips to identify a scam caller? What are some tips to maybe try to avoid or handle some of these types of phone scams? And this time we'll start with Josh.
Okay. So I'm sure everybody that is attending has probably at some time or another received a phone call asking if they would like to extend their vehicle's warranty, but those aren't the only types of scam calls that are going around. Certainly with the COVID-19 pandemic, these types of calls are going out trying to prey on, you know, people's urgency to act or react to certain situations. Things like getting a vaccine or getting a test or something like that, where where somebody may not fall into the category to have received the vaccine. Someone's really anxious. They get a call and say, hey, for $15, $20, you can get this vaccine early. We can get it for you. You know, if you're scared and not thinking about the consequences of that, you might be falling victim of a scam. And that goes outside of the COVID-19 pandemic as well. I know I usually receive the same calls over and over to extend my car's warranty, to lower my student debt, that I've actually got one this past weekend that I had won the, won some lottery somewhere. So you definitely have to keep in mind when you're receiving a call of, well, did I play the lottery? No. How did I win the lottery? And that kind of thing. So using good common sense when you get something like that, then you have to step back and look at it and think about, is this legitimate or am I being preyed victim on here?
Thank you, Josh. Flavio?
Scam calls are what I personally would say annoying. I get them quite often. And a good way to identify if a scam call is if they'll try to ask you for information, like your bank account information, some account password, the most common one, your last four digits of your social security number to verify who you are. And a good way to tell that these are scams is because you didn't sign up for anything or looking to change anything of your information or sign up for anything to that you would have to verify your account for. So a good way is just to watch out for calls ask for your information and not to give it out so easily.
Thank you, Flavio. Ashley?
So nowadays, most institutions, whether it be your bank or for, you know, insurance or things of that nature, will have you set up a series of security questions that pertain to your personal life. Like if they're going to give you a phone call, they will ask you a series of those questions. And a lot of places, even like your phone carrier, will send push notifications to your phone for you to verify that you are who you are. And in most cases, for most important things as well, they will contact you via mail on a letter that it does have the letterhead of the organization.
Chris?
So the call spoofing now is a really big problem, I think, where you get all these calls and they're all local calls now. They're places that could be, you know, next door to you, a business. And it's an issue for me because I always answer them. I have a son in school. My wife is a nurse locally. And I never know who's actually calling me. The problem is once you pick up those phone and you answer and you say hello, they know that there's a live person on the other end of that phone, and that information gets distributed out to a bunch of other telemarketers, and you're going to receive a bunch of calls. The best way to prevent that is, even if you do have to answer that call, is not to say hello. Wait to hear something on the other side of the line, because they are looking for that answer from you. They are looking to hear that hello. And if you don't hear anything, you should just hang up without responding, and that will help prevent you getting future phone calls.
Kendrick, can I follow up with something that Chris said?
Yes.
Chris, the spoofing of the phone numbers is, you know, yeah, it makes it appear like, you know, I once received a phone call that actually had spoofed my own phone number. So I was calling myself.
Mm-hmm. Unbelievable.
I've had that happen as well. Scary stuff. For our third question, remote work in school. According to one industry group, broadband use has surged more than 30% during the pandemic, and probably more than that, actually. With the increase in working and attending school from home, the unsung hero is our home router, which Dr. Ciampa mentioned earlier. That home router brings the internet to all of our home devices, and many of us are surprised to learn in the keynote today that the average consumer home router is not secure, even new ones, and is running old software. So what are some of the more secure routers that are available in 2021, and why should all of us go out right now and purchase a commercial grade router? What are some additional techniques that we might use to lock down our home routers that may not have been mentioned? I'll start with Flavio this time.
A router that I personally would recommend is the Netgear BR500 VPN. The reason for this is that it has an integrated firewall and a VPN, but it's not reasonable for everyone to just get up and get a new router. Routers do cost a lot. And so the best way is just try to secure your own home router the best way you can by changing your router's preset passwords, like the admin password and network password that comes already with your router when you buy it. And if your router allows you to change, to make sure that WPA3 personal is on.
Thank you, Flavio. Ashley?
So while there are tons on the market right now, they're all going to function about the same. My suggestion, the biggest thing is making sure everything is up to date. We can set routers to, you know, manually update on, like to be manually updated or to automatically update on their own. Even though they're set to automatically update, I would make it a habit to go into that software and check on a regular basis just to ensure that all updates that may have been pushed to the device actually went through. Updates are very important as far as security is concerned when it comes to home networking. Also, trying to keep as much personal information about yourself out of your networking, like your network name or your password for your actual network itself. Don't use the dog's name if you send him out into the backyard and then you yell his name across the neighborhood to call him back in. We might not think it sounds like a big deal, but if, you know, if Remington is the dog that you call in and that's the password to the network, that's actually displaying a lot of your information. We actually use Calix routers with Greenlight and they have lots of built-in security.
Excellent. Chris?
So I did a little bit of research for this question prior to this Zoom meeting. And I've seen, like our keynote speaker said, that there are a lot of routers that are sold new at Best Buy for $150, $200 that you think you're getting a high quality router that support security from over 10, 15 years ago that don't even support WPA2 encryption or anything like that. So I think when you're looking to purchase one, you really need to be careful and spend extra time to research the type of security that they're offering. Because again, the price range, you could think you'd be buying something of quality and it really turns out that it could be, you know, not right for you. So it's my recommendation to anybody would be to do research on the security type and the features of the router, regardless of what the price point is.
Good points, Chris. Michael?
Yes. For me, I usually, I don't recommend anyone having to go out and buy a brand new one. Like I said, they are a lot of money. I just recommend like keeping the one you have up to date. Then also you could go in and change the default password of that router, the address. Then you can also make sure you change the username and password because it's always just a Google search away. You can Google search in every brand name and find a username and password. And then also with the one I have, it's a Linksys. I forget the model number, but it has an app where I can go in and create separate networks. So for my Internet of Things, I can put that on a separate network, then have my devices on a separate network. Then I'm also able to go in and see who all is connected to my network. So I can go in and see a unknown device and kind of go and start investigating then to see if anyone has maybe found a way on. So I like those because the app, I can check it from my phone anywhere. So that's some of the things that I would recommend.
Thank you. Josh, do you have anything to add?
Sure. I would also say, in addition to what everyone else has said, is also implement layers of security. You know, you can change your default password. You can also change the IP range that your router is using for DHCP. So it's not just the conventional right out of the box IP ranges that it's using. You can use things like MAC address filtering. Most new routers have that capability now. And turn off your guest Wi-Fi if you're not planning on using it. You know, usually my friends don't like coming over because I have to give them a new password every time they come over. And also you can turn off your 2.4 gigahertz band, since it's going to have a much broader range. Depending on the size of your home, you may not need that much. You may be able to get by just fine with the 5 gigahertz. That's a little bit more concentrated, and you're not just blasting out your wireless signal to your neighborhood for anybody riding by to, you know, just start poking around.
Kendra, a thought that comes to my mind too to add, and these are all excellent suggestions, is to turn off remote administration on your wireless router. That would prevent someone from the outside be able to, who could not be able to get in and make those changes. Yeah.
Right. Excellent tip. Thank you. So our next question deals with something called Zoom bombing, and that's a relatively new term. Many of us have probably experienced Zoom fatigue in the last year and a half due to all these virtual meetings. Naturally, with the pandemic came, of course, an increase in people working and attending school from home and video conferencing. So who can tell us a little bit about Zoom bombing and what tips that you might have in regards to video conferencing through Zoom or any app? And we'll start with Ashley.
So sometimes we take for granted the things around us and how much information they can actually provide to someone looking in. So Zoom bombing has a lot to do with people using things in the vicinity of you to basically create clues to answer questions that may be able to leak into your private life. One of the tips that I may suggest is to find a place that you designate for your Zoom calls, whether it be near a window or with a solid background. Some people use pictures that they like to have as a backdrop for themselves, or just simply blurring your background, which is normally a feature of most video conferencing software.
Chris?
So Zoom bombing, I would say, would typically refer to unwanted intrusions into your Zoom meeting. There is some security issues. People say that you can get information from somebody on video, be it pictures around them or other objects. I think that you have to be aware of what you're showing in your background, like Ashley said, and make sure that you're in a neutral spot where you're not offering any personal information of yourself accidentally.
How about you, Michael?
One thing I would say is you want to verify that your meetings are set to private. And also, if someone sends you a link, you want to make sure that it's a link from someone you know. You want to kind of make sure that if you didn't know that you was going to be in a Zoom meeting and someone sent you a link, then why would they be sending you a link? So make sure it's kind of something that you're aware of. Like if it's just spur of the moment, someone sends you a link, you know, you kind of want to pay attention to stuff like that.
Josh?
A few things you can do. Obviously, like Michael was saying, is verify who the senders are. And also, if you're organizing a meeting, most of the major platforms have the ability to allow the presenter or the organizer to accept people into the meeting. So you might want to enable that setting so you don't have somebody that's arbitrarily coming in and you don't really need them into that team's meeting or Zoom or Duo or whatever major player of video conferencing you're using. And also to make sure you're using a platform that's trusted. If you get a meeting invite from somebody you trust and it's still coming from, hey, meet with me 123@gmail.com, it's probably not good.
Flavio?
I have the same thing to say like everyone else. Just like make sure nothing in your background will reveal any personal information, like a state flag, a picture of your family, stuff like that, or a window that could lead to it showing how your neighborhood looks like. And also a good thing to keep in mind is to keep Zoom meetings private, so not just anyone can join in, and verify the identities of the people that are in the Zoom meetings.
Thank you, Flavio. The next question, human error is always an issue of concern, especially now with more people working and attending school from home. What do we mean by human error? And why is that even more of a concern now? We'll start with Chris.
From the employer side of it, People who are working from home obviously have very little accountability. They can be watching movies while they're working. They could be on social media. They can have friends over. They don't have to be home to do work from home. They could be out. And that opens up a lot of room to make mistakes, to not be paying attention, to be doing the bare minimum, you know, and you're definitely, there's definitely a more mitigating risk there for the employer, because there's no way for them to know that the employee is doing what they're supposed to be doing. And I think that that's an issue that there's probably no real answer for right now that I know of.
Michael?
Yes, I think with more employees starting to work from home, it usually when you're at home, you get comfortable. You're pretty comfortable. So you tend to let your guard down easily. So where at a job, you had other protection there for if you let your guard down, you had a security team that was monitoring the PCs. You had firewalls in place. But when you're at home, you know, some enterprises, they may have a VPN for you to come in on, but some of them, that's only for certain employees. It may be just for IT staff. So you, when you're at home, you get more relaxed. Then, you know, like Chris said, if you have company over, you know, you tend to just be doing both, you know, having fun with company, then doing work also. So you see something from work or email, it's more easy to just click on it and not even think twice and just go back to having fun with company. So
thank you, Michael. Josh?
Yeah, human error is certainly a broad subject there for security concerns. Going back to our previous topic, you joining in on virtual conferences, you may have to share your screen and whoops, there's my Amazon account and accidentally had my password manager with all my passwords revealed. You know, you might have accidentally shared the wrong screen or not muted yourself inside of a conference and, you know, yelling at somebody else in the house and, hey, the password is such and such. So human error is definitely always something to be aware of as much as you can, but like, we all are human. You get a link to something in your email and it says that it's going to a Zoom meeting, but if you hover over it, the URL is actually meetwithme123. You're sitting at home and you're comfortable, like everyone says, you probably won't take the time to actually look and see where that URL is pointed. But sometimes you just got to slow down and look at it and think about what you're doing before you just start going to it.
Flavia?
Michael stated, the human error thing is like when you're at work, employers usually typically have some kind of security set up already for you at the workplace. But when you're at home, you don't really think about that stuff because everything's already set up for you at work. So when you're at home, you don't think about it. You just go about your day and don't really see a reason to protect yourself because you never saw it as a problem in the first place.
Ashley, do you have anything to add?
Even when protecting our employers and ourselves from working from home, sometimes we also need to consider the people that we serve, just like here at the city. I know we all took lots, you know, pictures of our pets and stuff during working from home time that we had, just being mindful of like your screens being up that may contain information for your customers.
Thank you. So going back a little bit to video conferencing, and some say that cyber criminals can get information about us from our work from home photos and videos. So what are maybe some specific tips about what we can do to be careful about what's visible in our backgrounds? We'll start with Michael.
Yes. I know, like we went over a little bit before, you know, just kind of either putting up the virtual background or, you know, you can blur your videos because usually, like, you know, if a criminal, they're looking for some kind of information that gives them more detail about you, either your birthday, you know, your full name. You know, they might can see a street sign, something to kind of, like Ashley stated before, put the puzzle together to kind of make it easier for them to take that information and either sell it or use it against your friends and scam your friends. So you kind of want to pay attention to, you know, blurring your background, which to be honest, that was something that was, I had to get up to speed on, because coming from my previous job, most of my meetings was just done over a phone, or we use Teams, which it didn't have your photo or nothing. But coming here, I do more Zoom calls where my photo is showing. So, you know, I had to, you know, quickly learn about the settings in Zoom to blur your background and different information like that. So I think that's a couple of things that you can be aware of.
Absolutely. Josh?
Yeah, I think that the having meeting backgrounds is a really good idea for the virtual backgrounds. Mark has a really good one there. And also kind of keeping them simple using the KISS method. A plain white wall doesn't offer a lot of detail about you. So you can keep it simple. You limit the amount of information that you're broadcasting out in a meeting like.
Flavio?
It's normally best to just hide personal information. Like I have a Cisco flag right here, and that's about all the information it's giving in computers. But it is very important to make sure that you don't have any personal information out. Like I've stated before, the family photos or state flag.
And also sports teams as well. A lot of people are big sports fanatics and have all of that team gear in their background. How about you, Ashley?
Just the same thing everybody else is saying. And we might not think about it, but like certain colors. So if people see a color theme in your home, like there's lots of purple or lots of blue, those things all link, put pieces of the puzzle together for people. They see a picture in your background and you have five daughters. You know, that's quite commonly a password for a lot of people. So,
Chris?
I think it was pretty well covered. The only thing I would add is this should carry over, especially to social media pages too, as to what you put up there. You know, people like to show off new things in their home and their animals and their family, and they're going on vacation. I think that that needs to be limited, because you really never know who's looking at your page or who's looking at your, whatever you're doing on the computer is always, you know, accessible by somebody. So I think these same rules should apply to all aspects of what you're sharing with the public at any time.
Thank you, Chris. Let's talk about VPNs. We hear that remote workers should use VPNs. Tell us more about that. What are VPNs? Why are they more secure? And what are some things to keep in mind if we're using a VPN? Let's start with Flavio.
VPNs, also known as virtual private networks, can be used to hide your IP address and in some cases encrypt your data while surfing through the web. VPNs are typically useful for like when you're accessing the line. I don't know, just like when you're online on the web, it hides your data. So like, because typically with cookies, if you're on a website that you allowed cookies, they can see what you're looking at, how long you've been there. And sometimes they can see your information even after you leave. But a VPN can be pretty effective at hiding that.
Ashley?
VPN is probably one of the safest ways to work remotely, because it's basically like an extension of your network at the organization that you work for. It does put some restrictions on things. And oftentimes you can't make certain downloads or click on certain links. So it's just an extra layer of protection, which I think is very vital with remote working.
Chris?
So I think that using a VPN is definitely a requirement that you should be aware of and that people, everyone should know about. I especially use them when I'm outside of my house. A lot of times I will go to restaurants to get out of my house, do my schoolwork or do other things. And I absolutely will set up the VPN while I'm connected to some sort of public Wi-Fi. You know, it definitely will stop intruders from getting any information off of an unsecured network that I have no control over, the public Wi-Fi. So it's important for me to make sure that I, you know, use whatever safety, security measures that I can take, and the VPN is probably the best one.
Michael?
Yes, with VPNs, I think some things you want to consider is the, you know, the reputation of the VPN provider, their server network, like, are they big enough where if they have an issue, is you going to be locked out? you know, there's some things to kind of keep aware of when choosing one. But for me, I say I got my love for VPNs when I was a network technician for the healthcare facility, because being able to log in remotely via a VPN to remote back to our equipment to do any kind of troubleshooting was a lifesaver for me, because it would save me from having to drive 50 miles 3-4 o'clock in the morning. So it became, that's when I kind of found my appreciation for it then, when in those situations, because without it, it would have been plenty of late nights on the road for me. So
absolutely. Josh?
Sure. VPNs are a really great tool to have in your arsenal for securing yourself. They've become much more prevalent, much more available. There's a vast number of different VPN providers that are out there now for both enterprises and personal use. The one thing to keep in mind is that they're not foolproof. I think it was within the last year, there was one major VPN provider that had their own data breach, and some of their customers' data had been breached there. Also, the VPNs really only kind of secure when you're on it. So if you're connecting back into work and you're restricted for downloads, you go, well, I really wanted to download this Spotify installer, I'm just going to disconnect real quick and install it, and I reconnect. Well, I've already installed it on my PC, and now I've potentially introduced something vulnerable into my work network. So the VPN is definitely a great tool, but definitely need to keep in mind that it's not the end all be all for IT security.
Thank you. Another question that I want to touch on before we go to Q&A is about social media and dormant accounts. So I'll sort of try to tie this into to a social media theme. Part of staying cyber safe during a pandemic is protecting ourselves against social media scams, especially ones on Facebook. So what are some examples of this? What are some things to be on the lookout for? Why should we limit the amount of information we share about ourselves on Facebook? And if someone can touch on the issue of the fake coronavirus vaccine cards leading to identity theft, that would be great. Let's start with Flavio.
A very common cyber attack is on Instagram, where you'll get a DM from an account you follow, and it would be them saying, oh, you want a prize, click this link to claim your prize. And then you click on the link, and then now you've been breached, and then your account will send out another link to more people you follow. And then it's a very quick way for this attack to spread, because you think it's from someone that you know, you trust, and you click on the link and it gets spread out really fast. So just be careful of what links you click on DMs, because sometimes even your friends that you follow can be vulnerable to attacks, and you need to be aware.
Ashley?
So I know a lot of us are always like, man, I was thinking about that and it showed up in my Facebook feed, whether it be you looking at headphones or, you know, it's the holidays. So that's going to start being more and more prevalent, where you, you know, look at something in a, you know, a Google search, and then it's showing up on your Facebook feed, that product. Just making sure that the things and the links that show up on Facebook are reputable. Most of the time, if it is legitimate, it will have, you know, its own advertisement. It won't show up as like a pop-up, or it won't look sketchy for any reason. It normally has a following, a large following. So just being careful with those things that we search in search engines showing up on our news feeds, so that you don't get scammed out of money, especially during the holidays. Very common.
Chris?
So the big thing I would touch on regarding social media is you'll see some of these posts get floating around that have hundreds of thousands of responses that'll say something like, You know, your birthday plus the name of your car and your pet's name equals your Halloween costume name. And you know, everyone responds to these things and doesn't see the major issues. But it, in reality, it's just people getting information from you that you are volunteering. And I think that that's something that not a lot of people realize. And I think that people need to pay more attention to it.
Really quickly, Michael or Josh?
Yes. So for me, usually with social media, I see this a lot with Facebook, where you start getting friend requests from people you're already friends with. So where they done, a criminal or a hacker done created a fake profile in order to fool you to think that it's your friend. And if you happen to accept it, then they start sending you links. Hey, you want to make this quick money or you want to do this payout? So a lot of times I'd kind of be aware of a lot of that. A lot of that type of stuff. And also just when posting up, you know, how, you know, you hear tell of a lot of celebrities that may have got hacked or gotten robbed in some kind of way, all because of when they posted a picture, they put their location in there. So the criminal just looked at the location and knew exactly where to go and find them. So I kind of, you know, you want to pay attention to everything kind of that's in that category there.
Thank you. Quickly, Josh, do you have anything to add about social media?
Yeah, social media has just kind of been one of those areas that attackers have started targeting more and more, and you need to be more conscious about what you post, what you share, what you like, what you follow. All of these things can be a lot like having pictures in your office. You know, you like certain sports teams, you follow certain pages, and your friends can see that, but if your friend's account gets hacked, well, guess what? It's out there now. So you definitely have to keep in mind what you're posting, what you're sharing, following, and that sort of thing.
Thank you. I think we'll try to wrap up with a couple of questions that were submitted during the event registration. And one of those questions is, what cybersecurity tips do you have in particular for the retired or for seniors? And any of the panelists or Dr. Ciampa can jump in.
Yeah, one of the things, and we mentioned it in the presentation, is establish that relationship with your retirement account manager. So no action is taken unless, again, like with mine, you know, it's unless we're meeting face-to-face, then don't take any sort of action, even if it looks like it comes from my phone or, you know, an email or that sort of thing. So that can be kind of inconvenient, but with just the wide open liability you have, if someone were to clean out your retirement account, that's just something I think that, you know, we have to think about today.
I would recommend to see if you can. If you're a senior citizen and you don't know much information about, like, whether it's a scam or not, is to get family or a friend, someone that would probably know more information on it, just get them to check it out, or at least call the retirement and see if it's legit or what's going on, to ask questions for you.
But we do have one question in the Q&A live, and that is, how often should you change your home Wi-Fi password? Would anyone like to take that question?
I'll take that one if nobody minds. That sort of kind of also depends on how often you share it out. I usually like to, if I have friends over and I've had 5-10 people that have connected on, I'm changing it right after that event. Right after the holidays, anytime that I've shared that out more than a couple times, it's getting changed out. I wouldn't say there's a specific time frame of once a month or twice a year or anything like that that would indicate a good time frame to change that password. It's more around the circumstances around it.
I think the big issue is just the fact that you do change it on some regular basis. Some people have had the same password for everything. Almost forever, and that's always a bad idea. Wilson Community College offers information technology certificates and degrees for those who are interested in learning more about cybersecurity or information technology,
or in making a change to this high demand field that has a lot of opportunity for growth and salary? For more information, you may visit our website at www.wilsoncc.edu. Also look for some information coming soon about a new continuing education course in the area of fiber optics. Your attendance today means a lot to us. Thank you for making our third annual CyberSafe in the Gigabit City a huge success. We thank our keynote, Dr. Champa, our wonderful panelist, and Wilson Community College senior staff for their support of this event, as well as information technology staff and marketing staff for doing such an excellent job and always being wonderful to work with. I thank everyone for their support and for attending today, and stay cyber safe in the Gigabit City. Have a great day.